Mandukya Upanishad has only 12 mantras, and that is maybe not really voluminous, as you can understand. It's a very thin book. 12 mantras, 12 sentences, rather 13, 14 sentences, not more than that. Now, these 12 mantras were good enough. And these mantras were from the ancient sages, Upanishadic sages. India is a land where sages have been in abundance, just in abundance. No land, and no religion ever had such a huge succession and abundance of sages as India has and continues to have. So then there came Gaudapada. Now Gaudapada, he is a highly respected philosopher come saint. He happens to be the teacher of Govindapada, who was again the teacher of the great Sri Shankaracharya, Avi Shankara, Mool Shankara. So Shankaracharya, as well, whenever we think of Vedanta, the moment we say Vedanta, we think of Shankaracharya. Shankaracharya's guru was Govindapada, and Govindapada's teacher was Gaudapada. We don't know anything about Gaudapada. If you go to Omkareshwar, which is near Indore, there is a cave where Govindapada used to sit. The story has that Shankaracharya went there to learn from him, and he was lost in meditation. And there were many aspirants who wanted to learn from him, but his meditation was not breaking. And when Shankaracharya went, so there is a story how Narmada was in spate during monsoons. Flood waters were rising, and then Shankaracharya spontaneously composed his stotra on Narmada, and he put his commendal water pot, and the water was taken up in that pot and the water receded. So if you go to that cave, you will see that even today, of course now with the dam and all, water doesn't rise much. But one can imagine that if water rises, it will go under the waters. We know this much about Govindapada, that he taught and he was in meditation. As for Gaudapada, we know nothing. And some people say that Gaudapada was from Bengal. Gaudadesh is Bengal. So he was from Bengal. Probably he was from Bengal. But Bengal doesn't have a very strong Vedanta tradition. So we really don't know. Now, the real credit and merit of Gaudapada lies in the fact that after the Upanishadic sages, he's practically the first one who presents Vedanta so well. Vyasa is there, of course, but Vyasa appears to be more like a compiler. So we have all these great sages who gave us Ishopanishad, Kenopanishad, Thadopanishad, Mundakopanishad, and we come across great names in Chandogya Upanishad, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, sages like Yajnavalkya and all. And then suddenly, the tradition of names vanishes. And then comes Gaudapada, who is as historical as a person can be. And he felt that he should write an explanatory treatise on this Mandukya Upanishad, which had just 12 mantras. And he wrote 215 verses, shlokas. There's a difference between mantras and shlokas. 12 Upanishadic mantras are mantras. 215 verses of Karika, they are shlokas, verses. Karika is normally an explanatory commentary in verses. The importance of this karika is that it laid the foundation of Vedanta, particularly Advaita Vedanta, in a systematic way. And Vedanta has never looked back after that. The four sections of karika, the first one is Agam, where Gaudapada goes on quoting from the scriptures, whatever has been discussed in Mandukya Upanishad. And then Vaitathya. He logically demolishes any form of dualism, any form of duality. And then he brings Advaita. It's not only demolishing, you must tell what is your view. And then comes the peace. He takes up every other system of thought and shows how they are mutually contradictory and hence they cannot be accepted. So ultimately, Advaita remains. Gaudapada uses arguments extensively. And most of his arguments, in a nutshell, discuss Buddhist philosophers like Ashwaghosa and Nagarjuna and Vasubandhu. So we have this Shunyavad, we have this Kshanik Vijnanvad. All these philosophies are taken up and shown how they contradict each other, and they're discarded. So this is very obvious that Gaudapada was probably after these philosophers. Actually, it fits. If you see that way, then if Acharya Shankaracharya, he belonged to 8th century, and then Gaudapada should belong to 5th, 6th century. Because Gaudapada Karika uses a lot of arguments of the Buddhist philosophers. And tradition has it that Gaudapada was teacher of Acharya Shankara. When Bhagwan Buddha talked about Nirvana, he was talking about the same thing. But one body is giving birth to the next. The cycle has to stop. This is what Gaudapada also proves. He takes up different schools of philosophies and shows how they are contradicting each other. So actually, essentially, Gaudapada uses the arguments of Buddhist, and refutes them. So these Hindu religious people, they were kind of so shocked by this presentation of Gaudapada, which it appeared to them as audacious, that they could not contradict him, so branded him as Prachanna Bodha. A Bodha in disguise. Now Gaudapada, because the philosophy, everything will be demolished. Everything will be demolished. Now unlike Buddhism, where it becomes shunya, Gaudapada will say that you alone exist, Atman alone exists. So actually he was not a Buddhist, as his critics came up. The sheer vastness, knowledge that Gaudapada had is simply phenomenal. And the flight of thoughts leaves you awestruck. What thoughts?